So straight off the bat, you'd probably think that I'm going to talk about the time loop theory. If you don't know what that is, it's a pretty long theory that's been around for quite a bit of time in the Attack on Titan community. It pretty much just handles time looping, and that's everything that's happening within the story now has already happened before. Unfortunately, I don't necessarily think the same way. I'm not the biggest fan of the time loop theory, and there's a lot of reasons for it, but more specifically, time is a very weird constraint within Attack on Titan. The time loop theory, to be done successfully, has to have a lot of attention paid towards it. Writing time and events surrounded by time, especially looping ones, unfortunately builds a lot of holes, and you have to be very aware of everything that's going on regarding your time sphere. There's one thing that kind of corrupts the time loop theory rather heavily, in my opinion, and that is Ymir and the paths specifically. When you kind of put those together, having a time loop within the main construct of the story, and then over the top you have a concept that is benevolent to time, something that is not kind of bounded to the normal time needs at all. That's very difficult to interlock within the story, something that is benevolent to time, and then something that continues to loop over and over again. Considering Ymir is the kind of bread and butter of this time situation, there is a lot of holes already building within the looping. So where do I start? I think for me, it starts with chapter one. To you, 2000 years later. This is a statement the title of the chapter that is extremely important to me. Originally, when you read this, you're not entirely sure what it is meant to mean. You don't really understand it. And then when you go forward into the story and learn more about Ymir, learn more about the history of Titans, piece by piece, everything starts to unravel. What is 2000 years in the future? One of the biggest things we come to learn about is the paths, Ymir's paths. Now, Ymir is the original Titan, the first person to be a Titan shifter. What's important about her is her ideology and what she gave to her people. From what we know, she pushed the boundaries of evolution. She gave everything peace and prosperity. I don't think we ever really heard about her being evil or corrupt or dangerous to any extent. She built mountains and roads and civilizations with her powers to help her people. That in itself gives you an idea on what Ymir is like as a person, what she was like, and what she wants. When her soul is split between all 9 Titans, she is connected to them, and she herself is benevolent to time, as we come to find out. Now, what exactly does that mean? In a similar sense, everything is kind of connected by fate, meaning that Eren Yeager, Armin, and even Zeke, and all the other Titan shifters today were always going to be Titan shifters, because Ymir has already seen it. Because Ymir is already connected to every single Titan shifter that is currently and was before, since potentially 2000 years ago, which is when she was alive. So the title name To You 2000 Years Later is not a reference from Eren's perspective, but I personally believe a reference from Ymir's perspective. 2000 years ago, she already connected to Eren. And funny enough, the actual specific number is, I believe, very close. People done the maths, and 2000 years is extremely accurate. Regarding her age, when she was alive, how long it's been between then towards Eren, the 100 years, including within Paradise, as well as Eren's age, it leads up to almost perfectly around 2,000 years. There's something very important about this, however, that I think a lot of people gloss over, and that Ymir connecting to Eren specifically is the final point. Now, what exactly do I mean by that? For the most part, we know that Ymir can connect to the future Titan shifters, but for some reason, it stops at Eren. At least from our perspective, she has not seen past Eren, and everything takes the form and perception through Eren's eyes. He is the final person, and I think that's because Ymir already knows the outcome of this story. She knows that Eren will be the one to break this Titan curse and free absolutely everyone. What makes this a little bit more concrete is the fact that Titan shifters themselves can also somewhat connect to future Titan shifters. The biggest example was Kruger, as he's seen both Eren, Armin, and Mikasa through the perspectives of the past. This is vitally important to understand, because not only did the time loop theory kind of build off that idea, but I think where it actually lies is that Kruger already connected to Eren at that point. He didn't connect to Grisha, he connected to Eren. And the one person that can showcase this to people is Ymir, which leads me to the idea that Ymir has been controlling all of these situations bit by bit. Now, you're probably wondering, how? How is this possible? How can Ymir kind of interject with anything? Do remember that a portion of Ymir is connected to every single Titan shifter. Funny enough, a lot of Titan shifters that have died have specifically seen Ymir, and more importantly, a place they call freedom. a very beautiful place that has no war, that has no racism, that is tranquil and very beautiful. Now, originally you would think that would be heaven or, you know, the afterlife because these characters were passing away. But what if it was something more? What if what Ymir was showing these characters wasn't actually the afterlife, but what the future held for the Titan Curse? What the future would evidently be like after Eren concludes everything? This would kind of go to showcase that everything they've done up to this point has not been in vain, that they have been pushed onto the right track, and that everything they've done within their Titan kind of lifespan will lead up to a beautiful future, this quote-unquote freedom, as Ymir has already seen the outcome for it. She's just kind of dictating the result a little bit, tweaking certain characters and showing specific characters what they need to be shown to get to this specific outcome, to get to this freedom. This is in the form of Zeke Jaeger. As us as readers, this is the first time we actually seen someone interact with Ymir without the conclusion of death. Zeke was very close, and Ymir appeared in front of him and even kind of healed him specifically. Now, that was more so metaphorical in that sense, but Ymir made her presence known and shown Zeke something that changed his perception a little bit, or even hardened it. I found that very interesting. What if what Ymir showed Zeke was something to keep him on path, to keep him on track, not to detour from his original destination? It may be a long shot, but hell, maybe Zeke even knows that he is not the one to break this curse thanks to Ymir, that the euthanasia plan is not going to work. But Eren is the person that's going to stomp all of this. And she reiterated that towards Zeke. This is the freedom that you're going to see if you continue on this path and help Eren. He is the only person that can currently do this. This is only a very small portion of what Ymir has actually done. This sets up pretty much everything that's going on at the moment. The fact that Ymir has potentially already seen the outcome and the freedom that she's showing to all these people that have passed previously that were Titan Shifters was actually the freedom that Eren managed to obtain. So how do we break it? How do we stop everything? What does Eren have, or what is he doing that is completely different to everyone else? The first biggest thing is the multiple Titan Shifters that Eren has, the multiple abilities. This is something that I don't think any other Titan Shifter has ever been capable of, or has even tried. Obtaining 2, 3, 4, potentially 9 in total Titan Shifters in one body. When you think about the curse and the Titan ability being transferred over naturally to someone, when a Titan Shifter dies, if it is not controlled, it will naturally go over to the Eldian people. If you were to kind of intersect that and stop it and rewrite it in a way where the Titan Shifting curse couldn't transfer over to people at all, wouldn't that break the curse? The thing is, no one could theoretically rewrite it because of the amount of disparities between each Titan Shifter. Everyone has a different amount of time until they actually die, and the curse is passed over naturally or is pre-selected, which is what Marley has been doing for years. If one person were to hold all 9 Titan Shifting abilities, technically no one would get them. Now, even more so, if that one person were to potentially crystallize themselves, and let's say they don't actually age within that crystal, I don't think any other children or any Eldian people at all would obtain the Titan Shifting ability. Nothing would transfer over. So how does this work in terms of the conclusion of the story? We potentially know the build-up for it. We know Ymir has been handling a lot of different things. We know she potentially has seen the future through Eren's eyes and the conclusion that he's going to bring. So how does it actually end? This has a lot of different ways to go. The biggest one is Eren's sacrifice towards everything, and the fact that certain things can be rewritten, which is something that is very important. This is going to obviously be the most vital piece of the puzzle, as it was introduced as a very vital piece. The euthanasia plan is literally based off the idea of rewriting the Titan Curse specifically. Considering the Titan Curse is interlocked with the Eldian people, rewriting it and rewriting the biology aspect of humans already that have nothing to do with Titans on the Eldian side is completely insane. It's a very important piece of the puzzle. Stopping Eldians producing children stops the curse. Yes, that does work, but you obliterate an entire race. How do we get around that? If we can do something so intricate like that, what else can we do? I think without a doubt, maybe Eren already knows a situation like this, whether Ymir has showed him specifically or whether he's come to the conclusion on his own. But rewriting the Titan Curse specifically so it does not transfer over naturally, to completely abolish the kind of current cycle of Titans and breaking the kind of jump between Titan Shifter to a new human being. If we can rewrite the Eldians so they cannot reproduce Zeus, I guarantee we can rewrite Titans so they can kind of be null and void. That all of the Titan serum is completely useless. That the transforming into mindless Titans, which is what Marley has been doing to innocent people, is also null and void. Doesn't work. Titan Shift is transferring over or even trying to eat another Titan Shifter wouldn't work either. Basically, the activation for it would not work at all. No Titans of any kind would be reproduced in any sense. No mindless Titans, no Titan Shifters, no abilities at all. It's kind of the end all of end all rewritings. It's like taking the euthanasia plan but timesing it by 10, but more specifically just for the Titan curse, not for the specific type of people. If that is the case, what does Eren actually need for this? He's got a couple of Titans within his body. He's got the power, he's got the intelligence, he's got the royal blood known as Zeke, and potentially Historia if that could work, right? It's kind of either or at this point. Supposedly, you know, Historia has to be Titanized, but maybe something within her blood is a little bit more specific, but then again, it doesn't really matter because Zeke is also there to be used as a perfect example of royal blood. That is all Eren actually needs. So does Eren activate the rumbling, completely obliterate his opponents, the people that are continuing this cycle of hatred, which is all based in Marley right now? And once he causes this mass destruction, once he becomes this massive pinnacle of hatred that people view him as, he then rewrites the Titan curse. Mind you, I think Eren specifically knows what he's doing, and the only person that can do this is him. He's willing to harbor all of this hatred. Humanity's hatred towards Eren, because of all of these crazy things that he is doing, is justified. But then they realize that what he'd done was for the future. Yes, he wants to destroy all Titan. Yes, he wants to obliterate everyone. Yes, he has all this hatred, but his hatred, I think, is completely justifiable to the future that he wants. This freedom, this breaking free of a birdcage, he knows power is necessary for it. He knows to break free of it is necessary. He knows he has to wipe out his opponents in some way, shape, or form before he can rewrite everything. What does this conclude to, though? The final piece that kind of connects onto this is more so Historia and her child. Her child will most likely be the biggest thing that comes from this, as if you haven't already seen, the final page of the story, the very last panel, is of a supposed person holding a child. And this child is born without the Titan curse completely, meaning that whatever or whoever managed to break the Titan curse was successful. Who is this person? We don't entirely know. A lot of people think that this is adequate to the time loop theory, but I do think that this is Historia's child, and in my opinion, I actually think the person is Armin. This is something that I thought about rather briefly, but it actually makes a lot of sense. The biggest thing for me right now is who controls the final Titan power? Who will be the last living Titan to exist? I don't expect Eren to rewrite the Titan curse and then they all start to crumble and disappear. So what exactly would have to be done? This also interlocks a couple of different things currently within the story. One, the idea that Armin is going to be humanity's saving grace. He is going to be the person that saves humanity. We've known this for a very long time. Throughout the entirety of the story, Armin is a very important character for this reason. So when is it going to come true? When is it going to shine? The other thing is Armin's perception of Eren. A lot of people think that Armin is naive towards the situation, that he has too much faith in Eren, but what if it was something else entirely different? What if the reason why Armin believes in Eren so much is not just because of the bond that they have with one another and because Armin knows Eren to such an extent and their bond, but could it be possible that Eren has already connected to Armin regarding the path? Now you're probably wondering, how would that work? Would that mean that Eren would pass all of the Titan shifting abilities onto Armin? Maybe so. The reason why I think Armin could be the final person to have all of the Titan shifting abilities is a couple of different reasons. One, I feel like only one or two people can actually be a Titan shifter in order to see if this curse is broken. I don't think 9 different Titan shifters, especially some on Marley's side and some on Eldian's side, wait this thing out to see if it's possible. If Eren takes all of the hatred so no one else has to, gets all of the dangerous deeds done, obtains all of the Titans potentially, other than Annie, but he could obtain Annie as well, and then offloads it onto Armin, and maybe even tells Armin how to rewrite the curse, then Armin will technically be humanity's biggest savior. He will be the last living Titan shifter to exist. He would then carry out his remaining years that he has as a Titan shifter and see the birth of Historia's child to make sure that the curse is actually broken. So that final panel could actually be Armin holding Historia's child. Now, we actually got words for that panel and that character saying to that child, "We are free." What if this is Eren and Armin and even Ymir saying it at the exact same time? Armin kind of channeling Eren's ideology, and then Ymir obviously being connected to them both, seeing the firstborn child without the Titan curse, everything being broken and destroyed right there in front of them. That is the outcome. That is a result of all of this hatred, of all of this continued cycle of pain and manipulation and torture and war has all come to an end. Thanks to all of the tragic efforts that Eren has gone through, thanks to Armin being the last person to see this and view this, to hold on to this massive weight and importance, we are free from three different people, Ymir, Eren, and Armin saying it at the exact same time. And I think it would be funny too if Historia's child would rightfully be called Ymir, after obviously Historia's friend, which is also the same name as the original Titan, thus coming almost completely full circle. It's not actually a reincarnation of Ymir, but it's almost like an ending point for the full circle, and a very beautiful way to end it at that. I think the biggest hiccup in all of this is Annie specifically. She's stuck in a crystal. If she gets eaten, then I think a lot of people would be disappointed with that. So maybe Armin specifically isn't the last person to actually be alive as a Titan Shifter, but Annie breaks free as well. We don't know if she ages in that crystal. We don't know if the curse can jump over with that. But if Eren or even Armin can rewrite the curse so it doesn't actually jump over to people, Armin can break Annie free, and they can kind of live as the final two Titan Shifters to ever exist. What is the biggest thing to take from this? The fact that Ymir has potentially been channeling Eren since chapter 1, and that she has potentially already seen the outcome of the entirety of the story through the eyes of Eren, potentially through the eyes of Armin. Has what Ymir been showing people regarding freedom through these paths actually been the future of what Eren is about to achieve? This beautiful place with no war. And at this point in the story, is Armin actually slowly connecting with Eren because of the past? Because Armin may potentially get all the Titan shifting abilities to be that final person alive. Hence why Armin has so much faith and so much realistic intention towards believing in Eren, because he's already connected with him. He's already potentially seen the outcome to an extent. He already knows what Eren's going to do. Just like how Kruger seen Eren, Armin, and Mikasa before they even existed in the world. There is many different concepts and ideas and themes that can be switched in and out for this entire video. But I think something like this and everything that I've talked about is everything that incorporates Attack on Titan since literally chapter 1. The biggest thing for this is Ymir and how she is completely benevolent to time and how she connects to every single current Titan Shifter. But everything after Eren specifically has not been shown. She has not seen past that point. She has not potentially seen past Armin. I don't know if she's seen through the eyes of Armin specifically. I don't know if that's like a big kind of reveal that we're waiting for, but I do heavily believe that the freedom that she's showing people is specifically the freedom that is obtained right at the end of the story. She has already seen the outcome for it, and is the reason why she kind of showed herself to Zeke to kind of reinstate his faith, to stay on this path and you will change the future. Your euthanasia plan is not entirely correct. That is not what's going to free this world, but you will evidently go down as a martyr that will help get to a point of freedom. And I think Zeke believed in that faith. I think realistically only time will tell at this point. There is a lot of information within this video, and all of it can be dispelled rather easily just with a bit of time and with the release of new chapters. But a lot of this stuff has a lot of weight, a lot of impact, and like I said, a lot of it can be changed in and out to suit more specific situations, but the overall architecture for it seems very appropriate. If it's not the ending of the story, then so be it. But this is an idea that has incorporated a lot of different events, a lot of different evident points from within the story alone, and almost seems like it could be a legitimate thing. But then again, I ain't Hajime Isayama, so whatever he does, I'm truly excited for, and only time will tell what the real ending of Attack on Titan will actually be. So with that being said, that is basically it. If you have made it to the end of this video, I want to thank you wholeheartedly. I know there is a lot of information, a lot of stuff within this video. I apologize for it being so long, but when I said that I was making a pretty big theory video, this was it. I've probably missed a lot of stuff, and I know a lot of people will correct me on a lot of different things. That's perfectly okay. But if you have your own theories or your own ideas, please let me know. There's so many different ways that this can go. There's the time loop theory. There's this theory of mine, which kind of incorporates a lot of different things. There's a whole bunch of other theories out there. Sure. Even if you have ideas that adds onto this theory to make it more concrete that I've missed, let me know your thoughts. How do you think Attack on Titan will come to its conclusion? Because I know a lot of you will have some extremely good ideas. But I'm actually going to end the video here. I hope you guys enjoyed, and I will see you in the next one. Goodbye.